Hey folks, Dr. Mike Ozertel here for Renaissance Periodization. Quick preview of chapter 13 in the Renaissance Diet Book 2.0. If you're interested in the stuff I'm saying, this is just a super grand description here. Give the book a shot, and the link to buy the book is in the description of this video. So here's the deal. Chapter 13 is about special diet circumstances. This is going to be a very grand tour because this is a really pretty big chapter. It covers a lot of ground. Let me tell you about what we talk about in this chapter. And then towards the end of the video, I'll actually give some good recommendations on at least one of the sections, kind of as an example. So we talk about, first thing is twice daily training, right? So, you know, yes, diet is pretty straightforward. If you train once a day and you wake up at a certain time, go to sleep at a certain time, you have a training session. If you train twice a day, things can get considerably more complicated. Nutrient timing plays a bigger role. This chapter addresses all the ins and outs to make sure that if you train twice a day, you can take care of your nutrition in such a way that is closer to optimal. And that's going to take some work, right? If you train twice a day, the good thing is you're probably means you're more serious about your sport endeavor. And it probably means you're willing to do the legwork to read a chapter like this and really figure out your nutrition more fine-tuned. In addition, this chapter will talk about a variety of special health circumstances and special life circumstances, like pregnancy. All right, we talk about details on weight gain rates and restrictions, as well as some post-delivery stuff. So lots of really good stuff there. We talk about menopause, weight gain risk, how to counter that, so on and so forth. We do a little bit of discussion of some special health conditions, PCOS, hypothyroidism, the two types of diabetes. Not an extensive intervention on those, because honestly, if just to get familiarized, you can read this book, but if you really want a ton of assistance on that, something best done with a very highly qualified registered dietitian, diet coach. All right, and then towards the end of this chapter, we have endurance sport dieting, which takes up it's a pretty big section. You think, well, endurance sport, just like every other sport, yes, in many ways it is, but there are some special considerations that are a little bit different for endurance sport. And it's interesting because endurance athletes were some of the first people ever to look into the science of sport nutrition, so much so that probably the first 20 years of sport nutrition was almost entirely consumed by questions of endurance athletics enhancements. Why? Because nutrition can make a huge difference in your endurance performance. Not like if you just look at the numbers, you're like, oh, that's only 5 minutes difference. But the race is 2 hours long. 5 minutes, you don't even see the person behind you. That's like 20 placings different, right? So it's a really, really big deal. What kind of things do we address here? Well, first of all, the different kinds of volumes of training that people do and how the carbs and calories match up to them. Because the volumes of training and endurance are so massive, some of the recommendations should just seem wonky in any other chapter. But in this one, they're like, okay, that's why it makes sense and here's how to calculate them. We can talk. We talk a lot about in this chapter about intra nutrition, right? We sort of in the other chapter say that intra training shakes are like, you know, okay to use. They help a little bit, especially if the workout's longer than an hour, pretty intense. Yeah, gee, you know, a lot of endurance training, most of it, if we're going to call it endurance, is over an hour long in training, and you know. There are some really, really interesting ways to supply training, especially when you get on the bike and you're doing 4 to 6 hour rides, etc. There are some solid foods in training that you can eat is one of those quirks. So we talk about that. We talk about fat intakes and the carb need with reference to caloric constraint. So, you know, how much carbohydrate does an endurance athlete need at a very high level? The answer is so much that sometimes it's actually hard to get fats in. And sometimes an endurance athlete has to lower their dietary fat to levels that are pretty low, not because there's something wrong with fats or that they're adipogenic. I mean, that's not a concern for endurance athletes because their calorie burning loads are so high. It's really the only reason we lower fats a little bit more than you would expect is to allow that many more carbs to be consumed. And lastly, in that chapter, we also talk about hydration and electrolytes. You know, hydration and electrolytes in normal training is kind of like, you know, just take in fluids, plenty of electrolytes, do a good job, monitor your urine color, and you'll be fine. With endurance athletics, you have to plan ahead. Because if you get dehydrated on a run, on a swim, on a ride that's true endurance length, you are going to be in a position where there's nothing you can do to save your performance if you're dehydrated halfway through the race or even through training. So it's just a bonk session. You just suck, right? So we're going to talk about a lot of really, really in-depth stuff here. And I think it's a really great chapter. Check it out.